Ready?
We do everything together. We're like two peas in a pod. We never leave each other's side. Like, I go to work with her and help her out.
All right, take care. See ya.
Oh, clever. Who told you to do that?
I do it myself, mate.
This is all the rubbish. Hmm? All the rubbish, if there's any more rubbish anywhere.
I started to stop going in year seven. Like, I started wagging school all the time. My parents not knowing. I wouldn't do anything. I'd just walk around the streets all day. In my head, that was much better than getting bullied every day.
Where's the bin liners?
Behind the massage chair.
I just completely stopped going and never went back, literally. And that was the best day ever. Because I felt as if I didn't have to be put in pain anymore. I have to be crying myself to sleep every night. Just, I was away from everything, all the drama.
I spend the vast majority of my time in here. I'm not really usually anywhere else. I listen to metal and I wear hoods and baggy jeans and I wear thongs rather than shoes. I don't like to do a lot of stuff and I do stuff very different from that of other people. I am extremely intelligent and usually have a lot to say, but there really isn't that many people that would understand it.
It's just lovely.
Okay. I felt like everyone would look at me as like a goon head, a drunk, like a low life, like just a feral kind of thing, you know?
You're going to be part of the corporate team.
Awesome. I thought that most jobs wouldn't really take Aboriginals and I didn't feel like I fitted in like with everyone else.
Beautiful. All right, let's go shopping for this.
I thought I was just going to be like my mum and dad, just living off Centrelink and being a pensioner my whole life.
I'm just getting out my stuff because I'm moving in a new house. So I've brought what I have. I've got a blanket and a bag where I have the school bag and shoes and a laptop.
Yeah.
Nothing else.
It took me a very long time to understand the educational system. I don't have anyone that outside could help me in my assignments, etc. I don't have the confidence like to stand in front of a teacher and say that I haven't done it. It is hard because especially the other student, if they go in, if they enter the house, there's a mom waiting for her. Hi, have you done your lunch? You must be tired, but in here, you just talk with the walls.
Used to be that a job on the line at Holden's was the best job you could get in Elizabeth. This was the aspiration. To have Dad working on the line at Holden's was what families wanted. And you were secure for life. At least 13,000 jobs are going to disappear once Holden's closes down. We know that a lot of the reasons that young people drop out of school aren't because that young person doesn't like school, it's because of their family circumstances. So we can imagine that as the economic environment gets worse, so too young people will find reasons to have to be away from school.
If you have a life where 4 days of the week you're not at school and you're not doing anything and you're gravitating to people who are doing exactly the same, then, and I've acted for many people like this, but it inevitably leads to a way of trying to survive, which you can't do it lawfully because you don't have the education, you don't have the skills.
Before I got bullied, this sounds so like up myself, but I thought I was perfect. The thing that would get to me the most is being called fat, but the worst thing was about it all, like it wouldn't stay at school. He'd carry on over Facebook, getting inboxes, threats. They'd say, tell me to go kill myself. I'm ugly, I'm fat, I'm not good enough to live. I should just die.
Sit. Good boy. Good boy.
I didn't think there was anything wrong with me. I was just a kid going to school to do my work and learn.
To start with, she wasn't actually going to school and I didn't actually realise. She kept it a secret from me.
I just put different clothes in my bag so I can change.
I was shocked, absolutely shocked. Because after that, I sat down with Taylor and she showed me some journals that she'd written.
Okay.
That's enough.
Okay.
Stop.
I'm putting this in the bin.
Can you chuck that in the wash? This is one of Taylor's dark moments. She just pretty much puts raw emotion on paper and how she's feeling. How could someone you love so much be source of your pain? Have you ever wanted to end your life just so you could feel at peace with yourself? That maybe would feel pain for you?
I wouldn't tell anyone. I'd self-harm over it. It was just like instant relief as soon as I'd done it. And then you'd feel like everything was better, all the pain was out.
The real self-harming to ease the pain. I don't know of too many young girls that Taylor knows that aren't doing it or haven't done it.
I didn't want to do anything in my life because I thought there was no point trying, because I tried going to school and it didn't work out, so I just gave up.
My mum was into the whole drug thing. And due to that, she ended up having me at a very young age, which caused her to try to take care of me when she was still in the mix with all this stuff, which kind of got me into it. And then I ended up being taken care of by Nan. And then, for other unknown reasons, throughout the process of the other years, things such as violence, abuse, and other such things ended up getting into the mix.
James has pretty much lived with me for most of his life. Even when James was at kindy and preschool, he never seemed to really fit in. He had always struggled with social interaction with others.
School is probably in my top three. Most worst lasting experiences of my life, without a doubt. And every day of it, I despised everything to do with it. There was so much happening at once. I was being bullied without knowing why. I was having to deal with all of these learning problems and not knowing why everyone else was able to do everything right. I was having to deal with teachers that weren't aware of the fact that I have these learning problems and simply thinking I'm neglecting the work for no reason.
Midway through the first year, he was only attending maybe 1 or 2 days a week. I'd walk him down the bus stop to try and make sure we got on the bus, and I'd say, look, I'll go and get your Maccas, you know, if you do go to school.
Because children get impressions from their parents. And their parents could be religious, their parents could be racist, their parents could be stupid, they could be sexist, they could be et cetera, et cetera. And then that passes down to the children. And then the children pass it off to their friends, and then that becomes their way of life. Nothing. No, nothing. 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 Absolutely nothing in any way. I know nothing conclusive about him in any way. I really don't see the point of role models. I mean, to me personally, even if I did, I've never had anyone that I've seen being brought up with or related to over a long period of time.
When I was about 11 years old, that's when I started like going through puberty, growing up, like, and my parents just didn't like the fact that I was becoming like a young girl.
Should we get a coat as well so that you can actually?
I started to have my own opinions as I grew up. Like, I seen things differently. I seen like how I want to live, and like I seen like things that like hitting kids is not like that's not the right thing. I'd go to school with bruises on my legs and stuff, and I'd colour it in with red pen so no one would ask me what those bruises were or who they were from and that. So that's when I got kicked out of home, like when Mum put me into a girl's shelter, and that's when I was living on the street for about 5 months with my friends. Like, I'd steal all my clothes, I stole all my food. Every day I just couldn't handle it. And when I went to school, I just gave up because I was like, what am I going to do? I'm not going to fail anyway.
Did you get a kidnapped
sleep
last
night? Yes.
Did you?
What's the main thing that's going on at the moment?
Family conflict, parents divorcing that.
Is it nice to be able to still visit your family and talk about what's going on with your life?
I don't really see my parents as my parents no more.
So do you just talk to them over the phone?
Yeah, yeah, I'll just casually have a talk here and there, but yeah. Nothing like special, like nothing family.
Yeah.
These young people don't have their parents when they go home. They don't have the parents to actually console them.
You don't really always need your parents for everything in your life, not really. But because I didn't, like, well, I never had them there, but even though I wanted them there, but they weren't there.
Tuesday, Wednesday morning.
Yes, I know what my day is.
Yeah.
I picked them.
Oh, you did you?
Yes,
I'm very
incredible.
All right, okay. Thank you.
It's a lot better than regular school. And there aren't that many kids there, and a lot of the kids there are a lot like me.
All right, so take a seat.
You can do your own thing, and you can wear clothes that you want to wear, and all that.
One of the activities that you guys are going to continue doing is you're creating your own restaurant.
He wants to remain in the flow program for the duration of his high school years. He's stressed and he never wants to go back to mainstream school, high school.
Flexible Learning Options, or FLOW, is a wonderful South Australian initiative whereby the funding that would have gone to the young person who's dropped out of school, that the schools don't have access to, is made available to youth work agencies to work with those young people to help them back on the education pathway.
All right, guys, so how are you going with that so far?
Well, I think everyone is individual, and schooling is too. So there's got to be different strokes for different folks. It could be that they've been bullied in school. It could be they might be carers for their parents. They can pick their own adventure, so to speak.
You're going to own a pub, come tons of fun. You're going to own a fine dining, and you're going to own a childcare centre.
Yes. So, see, we're getting there.
That's it.
And what did you do instead of going to school?
I'd sit at home, go on Facebook. I'd go to some lessons, and lessons I wanted to skip, I'd just go sit at the park across the road.
Kids who don't go to school have a reason. And they might not talk about that reason, but they do have a reason. Every person has a reason why.
In an ordinary school, you'll ask a teacher for help if you're having trouble with your work. And they'll explain it once and won't do it again.
I don't teach a group. I teach individually, one-to-one, and make sure that what they're getting is working for each of them individually.
Here we have about 400 young people. Absolutely. Who are re-engaging with education through FLOW, with an individual pathway that brings them back into education, perhaps initially with something a little bit easier, but then into the harder subjects.
No problems.
See ya.
See ya, take care.
South Australia has had some of the highest youth unemployment rates in the country. So if many of your mates, elder brothers and sisters are unemployed, why would you stay on at school?
What worries me are the FLOW students who are not accountable to a school. All it's asked of them is that for one day a week or 1 hour a week, they have an interaction with another person. And what concerns me about that is that it is not a preparation for real life. In real life, you cannot work a job one day a week. In real life, you cannot get an education by going to school one day a week. And so the question I ask myself is, what happens after? It was suggested to me that she needed a different kind of schooling. I wasn't prepared to accept that. I did not want my child to basically never be able to be educated. She started to play ice hockey, and suddenly she had an identity. She was a star at school because very few girls played ice hockey. The way that children should be encouraged to think is the opposite to the FLOW program. It should be, you can get there and you will get there as long as you put in the hard yards. And if you're willing to put in the hard yards, we'll support you.
And the hard yards is getting back into mainstream school.
Getting back into mainstream school. And secondly, if you are having problems, having the confidence to say what those problems are.
I came to Australia by boat. I myself didn't see how the ocean was looking like because I was vomiting. If I knew that it was that dangerous, believe me, I would have. Now if you give me millions of dollars to come back through the Indian Ocean by boat, I would say no. When I came to Australia, this was completely new. Like, I didn't know about Adelaide. What, everything was new.
So that's some long life milk.
We were living in mountains. We thought that everywhere would, every place in the world would look the same.
A lot of the new arrivals that we work with, they're overseas. They don't they don't go to school, they don't have an education. So I guess when Atif arrived here, he was expected to just slot into, you know, year 11, and there was no consideration given to the minimal schooling, previous schooling that he did have.
There was lack of communication with the teacher, so I thought that, okay, today if I get an off, it would help me that if I don't go to school, I will do that at home. But when you move and when you just, with the blink of an eye, the day passes and you say, you regret. Oh, wish I were at school today for the whole day.
On these young people, especially for someone like Atif, who they've come here on their own and they are responsible for the welfare of their family who's still overseas. So there's a lot of pressure in that sense to get an education, get a good job, you know, and provide for your family who may still be overseas.
Out.
Every child, if given the opportunity, will respond to firstly kindness, secondly belief in them, and thirdly a goal which is a stepping stone to a better future for them. It doesn't matter whose fault it is. We need to recognise that we are sacrificing the lives of this whole generation of young people because we're not prepared to accept that we need to invest in their future, and we need to do it in a way that does not deny them self-responsibility.
Well done, guys.
So I've been doing a work experience this week with Vicky Lee. She's made me like feel connected with my culture, and she's, yeah, she, like you, like she can see similarities with me as well as with herself. Oh, yeah.
Have you got a journal that you've been doing reflection?
Yeah.
Okay. So I grew up in the 70s when it wasn't cool to be an Aboriginal person, and I hit the streets. So I thought that to be Aboriginal I needed to drink and drug and do all sorts of things, because that was the stuff that was in my face about being Aboriginal. So there was a light bulb moment where I decided that I'd always wanted to go to uni, and I created that journey for myself.
I put you on this table.
Yep.
But you'll be sitting there with Ali, so you won't be on your own.
Yep.
Now she's decided she wants to be the first person in her family to get her year 12. Then she wants to be the first person in her family to go to university. But to be the first of something in your family is an amazing thing, but you're pushing against a lot of stuff in that.
I've just decided to keep all my family problems away from school. Like, I don't really talk to my parents anymore. Like, and I've got my own life, they've got theirs. So I'm growing up now, so you can't stay young forever. Got to move on somehow.
I suppose my mental health is my number one priority at the moment. I'm putting up with it extremely well and keeping it caged and not letting it get external, but no, I'm not coping.
In Afghan community, I have some friends from my community, and we have gatherings.
Ek salawat padhiyega. Allahumma salli ala
I don't make a lot of friends at school, honestly. This year, I have not been out with anyone, like any student. Interiors, I see myself a good person. I will be a successful man if I complete the university and make a family, marry someone and have children and a happy life and give the society good things.
For a while I wanted to be a surgeon. For a long time I wanted to be a surgeon. I had my mind dead set on that. But recently and spontaneously I decided to become a miner.
Why?
Because it pays a lot and it's simple.
In 10 years, I see myself with a job, probably even at university, with a nice house, a good family, and just being happy with myself. Like, that's all I want to be, is happy.
Sometimes, like 2 o'clock in the morning, I might pick my phone up and ring her in her bedroom and say, you want to go for a Macca's run?
In 10 years, I see myself as an air hostess, travelling the world, having a good job, getting paid good money, like when you're old, having your own house and stuff. A little girl and a little boy. But the little boy has to be older than the little girl so he can protect his little sister. That's what I see as like the perfect family.
Ah, yes, please. Thank you. Thank you. Come here. Come here. I don't think anything's going to change. We're there for each other, so it's only going to get better.
What's the worst that can happen?
Yeah.